Hello everyone, good evening to all and welcome to the second session of the workshop From Zero to Hero in Python. This is a partnership project between Bensar Ventures and Edicon International. So before we start the session, I would like to make some announcement to all the participants. We will share a link to the resource materials in the Zoom chat box during the session. Please follow up if anyone has missed it, and we will share a collect your attendance during the session. Please make sure to fill the necessary details, and we are going to close the link once the session is over. There will be a separate link to submit your questions, and also that will be also published in the Zoom chat box. And for the ones who participate through our FB Lives, we will share the same links in the comment section at the same time. So please follow up for the links during the session. On behalf of Bensar Ventures and Edicon International, I would like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Fikri Ismail, to conduct our session. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. Hi guys, good evening. My name is Fikri Ismail. I am a Microsoft MVP for developer technologies. And it's been like 15 years I'm working on these technologies. I started as a programmer and I'm still a developer as well as I do some architectural work. I think last time we talked about Python, how we get started and what the things like variables, strings, and lots of things. We had some questions answered, and then we move into the code directly. So last time we used, I'll just share my screen and just do a, let me check out this share screen. I'll just share screen. Yeah, share. I hope everybody can see the screen. Let me drag this into this area. So let's get started here. Last time I just showed you to you how we worked on these things. I'll just open the day one things. So these are things we did on last time, right? We learned about functions, how to create a function, and then we slowly just turn off my camera as well. Then right, last time we did was like we talked about how to create this application and a small Python code, and then we used another technology called Python, this Jupyter Notebooks. So Jupyter Notebook is very helpful to learn, like taking notes and just write some small code. So I showed you how to install the extension and how we use, like for example, we can easily create a Jupyter Notebook like this. It's just a simple file. We just start with like maybe just say day two dot, and then we have to give an extension name. For example, look at these extension names, IPyNB, right? So we'll just say, we'll say day one, or maybe we can just say sample test IPY, and then you have to say notebook NB. Then it will let you, you will get a small file like this. This is very important to you guys. Like for example, if you're just taking notes and writing some code for it, I'll just show it to you how to do that. If you missed the last class, just a quick thing, just click on this markdown and you can just say, let's use Python as a calculator, right? You just press Control and Enter, or maybe Shift Enter, it will move into the next line, and then you will get a, it's to say always markdown, then you don't need a markdown. This time you move your mouse here, and then you just click code. Then you just say 1 + 1 and Shift Enter. It will execute and then calculate these values. So for example, you just say print some text here. You'll just Shift Enter to get these things, right? It will just slowly, if you want to add a markdown here, Let's see how to use the print function. See, it's very simple and then it's very useful. It's like taking notes with code. You have this code. This, that's why last time I introduced you, you can just use this, or maybe you can use directly like Python codes like this. So we tried both ways last time, and we did some formatting on Python, and we created a function on Python. Just we calculated some salaries. We just give, like for example, we just gave some parameters, and then we create some optional parameters. All those things last time we did. This is kind of a small recap for you guys, what we did last time, right? So today I'm going to talk about some different areas. Like for example, we're going to start with some built-in functions with Python, right? How, what are the built-in functions? Function means we already used one. We used print. Print is a function. Built-in means we don't need any extra things. Like this is how we do this. I'll just open my PowerPoint and I'll show it to you. So let's create file new, a new file. So, right. So for example, this is Python. So for let's have a look. If you look at this, this is Python, right? Python will be whatever you downloaded from last time I showed, whatever you downloaded and installed, right? This is called Python. So Python language by default, it will get different functionality within the package. For example, I can just say a function. Print is a function that comes with Python, right? But capital P, it should be simple. Let me change the color. So now you will see it will built in. If you get Python downloaded, you will get these functions already there. You will already have it with you, these built-in functions. For example, there are lots of functions like this. If I just say, okay, print, I can just create, I'll tell you about another function called, like we can just say ABS, right? So ABS is another function which will calculate, it will give out an absolute value. Like if we just say, okay, -1, and then absolute value will be just 1. Whatever the value, it will remove the plus, the whatever the direction, minus or plus. So for example, we can just say another function called, these are called built-in functions. You can just say, take it as like sum of some items. Or maybe you can just say another function we already used. There are like functions built-in. If you go to Python documentation, you will see lots of built-in functions. You don't need anything else. Like if you have already installed Python, that means you have Python, and then you can just say, get me this function, and it will already work. Look at this. This is how we work. We'll just start with, I'll just close this one, save, yeah. And I have another Visual Studio Code open. There's nothing there, it says day 2, that's it. We'll start from here. You can just say ex1.python. I'm not gonna use any Jupyter notebook here. Today I'm gonna straight away. So because this is day 2, straight away I'm gonna use a Python file. This is how you start. You say, I'll say exercise 1. See the file name and the extension, two different things. That py means you have this Python. So last time there was a question asked like saying, how do you get these icons? So it was like a simple extension I have installed called material icons. Material icons. See, when you click on this one, you have got lots of icons because this is very useful and it will make this IDE very beautiful. Plus it's very useful. It's like a productive. Productive means you know, okay, if I miss something, if I just if I do a Python coding, if I just go back here, if I just say I just change this extension, let me double click, or maybe just say rename. If I change into CS, say it will say C# file. So it knows. So this file extension, and depending on the file extension, it will pick up what sort of things I have to execute. If I look at this, if we go here, see, it says C#. See, the IDE is intelligent enough to understand what you're working on. So I'm going to rename it to like, again, you can just say F2 or rename. I'm going to say, I don't need C#. I'm going to work with Python today. And then look at this. The IDE is very intelligent Visual Studio Code. It's very intelligent to understand, saying, okay, now it's a Python code. And as well as, if you execute, see, run. If you run this file here, let me just show back to you. Oops, it goes off. So it says here, run Python file in terminal. See, you don't have to worry about it. If I just say print, let's say run from ID, can you say run from ID, and you just save it. And when you just hit this play button, see, automatically it opens the shell and then it will execute your code. See, it's already there. Or else you can do, the way of doing is like, you can just open the terminal using terminal, new terminal, and you straight away, you can just say, okay, Python, and you will say ex1.py Python, and the code is run. Two methods. You can just execute from here, or you can from code. It's up to you, and it's depending on your preferences, right? So we'll start. Let's look at a built-in function. Now we are using these built-in functions called print. There are lots of built-in functions. For example, we can just say, let's see, another function will say ABS. So you just say ABS, and it says support ABS, return the absolute value of an argument. It says, if I say just 20, minus 20, and then I'm gonna say space, if you execute it, nothing will happen because it just executed. I didn't say anything to print anything. I'm gonna create a variable. Last time we used variable, we're gonna say, value equals ABS. Now it's a print value. We execute this one, it says 20 here. It's simple as that. It says 20, right? You can use that. That means absolute. These are the code built-in functions. There are lots of built-in functions. If you want, if you don't know about these functions, for example, let's say a new function. I just came across something, a function called type. It says type. So a function, this is again a built-in function in Python. We came across this function, we don't know anything about it. One way of doing it is like just move the mouse here and automatically your editor, that means IDE, Visual Studio Code will understand you are looking for some help. It says, okay, class type. And what does it do? It says type object or class or whatever it is. And then it will return the object's type, a new type. It will return the type of the, let's see how it works. How do we work? Or else you can just say, you can use another function, built-in function called help, and type this message. Help about type. Let's execute that. I'm gonna clear it. I'm gonna say Python ex1. See, now it gives you a nice little help here. See, it says help on class type module built-ins. It says module built-ins. It means, it's built in with Python. So nothing to worry about. It comes with Python and class type. This is how you use it. There are three types of methods. So this is how you read it. So there are one way of using it, another way of using it, another way of using it. So it means you have three types of using, three methods of using this function. It says, okay, one way of using it is like, you can just say object or name, basis, and the dictionary. And then you can just say just the object. And what this arrow means, this small arrow, that means what sort of thing this function get returned. It says objects type, it returns a new type. Let's see how it works. Let's, now we learned about it. Let's see how it works. I'm gonna say variable, sorry, it's a type. This is a string. Now, see, now we have created an object. Let's say Control S, let's try to execute it. Nothing will happen because we haven't printed it yet. See, let's go back and I'm gonna say, get it inside the variable, type, type output. And let's say equal. Next time I'm gonna put like, say print, type output, the variable. Assign this into a variable and then print the variable. Save and clear, sorry, clear and say Python example 1.python. And then see, now it says you have created a class of string. See, now this is how you find out what sort of things. If we just say type 9, it's a number, right? You just save it and you execute it. Now the output will say, it will say class of int, that means type of int. Now, if you say just like this, this is look the change what we made now, right? It's still a number 9, but we entered in between single quotes. Now when you just say save Python, and this is class of strings, right? Two different outputs. So the first one, it says even the same number, it says integer. Now it's saying class of string. That means anything you just put in between this single quotes, it will treat it as a string, right? Now let me show you something else. You can just say true. So look what will happen. Now save it, execute. Now it says type of boolean. See, now you can just type string, integer, string, boolean. So those are the things you can just find out the types. This is just a simple function we have used, right? Now look at this. Let me show you another function. There's another function called int, right? So there's a function called int. Now it says integer and base 10, convert number or string to an integer or return 0 if no arguments are given. Let's try that, whether it is working. I'm going to say output equals int. There's no argument given. Let's print the output and try. Output. Right, let's save it. I'm going to say clear. And let's say Python. See, so it's true. That says there is no argument is given and automatically it prints 0. See, now we have 0 output here. So that's one way. Let's try to put something like this, 123.976, a floating point number, right? Let's save it and let's clear it. Sorry, clear it, clear, yes. And let's run the code, Python. Now what did happen? Now it gives a number, see, 123, that means 123. But even though you went given, we have given like this. What does it mean? It means this integer, that int function can convert a number. That's the main point you have to think about. Convert a number or a string to an integer. That's the main thing, right? That means it converts a number or string to integer. For example, I'll give it to you like this. Let's say, right, number 1. I'm going to say 23. Number 2, let's say 40. You print these two out, saying number 1, 1 plus number 2. When you print it out, it's clear. When you print this out, it will say 63. See, no problem. The value is correct. But so give them as strings. Now let's say save and clear and run again. See, it says 2340. That means it treated as a string. So why you need these things? Now you have to convert this into integer. And then if you need the actual number or actual numbers, why you need these things? Because imagine you are creating user interface, like a web application, or maybe it may be just a Windows application, whatever it is, it will have a text box. Even though if you write text box in a number, these will be treated as strings, right? And then you have to convert into something like that. I'm going to say like, okay, please convert this number into an actual number, int, and convert. Convert, right? Then save it. Then let's try it again. Now you get the 63 back. This method is called, these functions we can use in programming, we call this Let's create another one. So we have a number here, not a number. We have an, let's say 2, 3, 4. This is, I'm going to say this blue area is a string in the memory. It's stored as a string. Or maybe you can just say string. In Python, we're going to say str. Now, when you convert this into a number, you can say again 2, 3, 4 int. Right? Now there should be a conversion. Convert this string to integer. We used a function called int. We called a function called int. This process, normally what we call is like we have a string and then we convert into an integer. Let's change the color, oops, sorry. A color to something else like design shape format, like a light blue, right? Now, string to integer. This process is called in programming typecasting. Right? We call it as a typecasting. That means the type is string, convert into integer type. That's why we call it typecasting. Most, lots of application will need this, right? Sometimes you might have a, this will be a string here, or maybe you might have something like this. You will have a floating point. Float type, it will be treated as like this. And then again, you might have to convert into an integer. So again, you can say float to integer. It's called a typecasting. So we have string, float, and convert into integer. Same way, other way around. You can do the same thing like this. Not just one way. It's other way around. We can use integer into float or maybe integer into string. That's also called typecasting. If you can guess, for example, you can just say, let me go back to my code. I will just show it to you. Imagine another example. I'll just come back. I'm going to say number 3 will be 40. Number 4 will be 60. The answer should be 100, right? So let's say, print number 3 plus number 4. As you guess, the answer will be, I'm gonna remark these things. Let's say remark these things. That means comment it out. Now only these things will be working. Let's go back to my code and let's say Python example. Oh, I didn't save it. Just save it back, clear. Now you have 100, right? The other way around is like if you just say string, convert this into a string. Same way. Let's see what will happen. Now clear. Let's check. See, now it says 40, 60. So this is how, these are two ways of doing it. These are called typecasting, right? So these called typecasting. Now we learned about few functions. If you want more functions, to learn about more functions, you can just go to docs.python.org. This is the website. I'll just type it here. It says docs.python.org. This website. Then search for Python built-in functions. You will get a list of functions and with examples and this is with examples, right? This is one way of doing it. Next step. Imagine there are things. Now we know about built-in functions. This area. These are called built-in functions. Imagine sometimes you might not know. Like for example, you might not know, or you, there are like plain, like maybe some application might need more than this, right? Like we have to get some external functionality. These are called modules. In Python, we call them as, let's create a star here. These are called modules in Python, right? These modules are right? These are called modules. These will be small code, like a module is simple. So normally the explanation of a module will be a module is simply a code file, right? A simple code file gives you some extra functionality, right? So these are modules. There will be plenty of modules out there. Plenty of modules out there to work with. Different modules. You can just say different modules, different shapes, different sizes, different modules. These can be leveraged or maybe used inside a Python code. Like for example, I'll give this is a module and this is another module and this is another module, right? If you want this module inside your code, you can just straight away get this module inside your Python code, right? Python code, and then you can just use them inside your Python code. You can just straight away. These are called modules, right? These are called lots of modules. Let's do different modules. Get inside your code and then work them, right? So they will get date time modules, numeric mathematical modules, file system modules, operating system modules. Lots of modules are there, right? These modules, there are two different things. Like if you example, you have all these modules inside here, right? And then Python has a thing called, we just get this module inside, right? This is called in Python, there will be lots, right? This is called Python standard library, right? Python standard library has lots of different modules. It doesn't come with that with the default built-in functions, right? So you need to import these functions, these methods, these libraries inside your Python code to work with, right? Lots of there. Like, how do we start? So built-in functions will do something, but if you need extra things, like definitely, because there is no Python code without importing a module, right? You start with that, and then you just start with learning these things. And then if you, and in a certain point, you will think, okay, this is not enough. We need some extra stuff. How do we get it out? So this is how to do that. Just these are called Python standard library. If you're looking at another different, like Python, we call it called Python standard library. If you look at other vendors, like if you look at Microsoft, Microsoft has a similar thing called a language called C#. The language comes with normal stuff, like whatever the built-in functions, like print, sum, ABS, like that. And then if you need extra things, right, it's called .NET framework. Like Python standard library, it's called .NET framework. If you look at Java, it says Java class library, like that, right? So any programming language, if you need, like if you are now you are learning Python, if you move into a different language, they have their different things. Like we're looking at Python, it was Python standard library. How do we get this thing into Python? That this is how you do that, right? Again, this is Python standard library will be within Python. And then sometimes you might need more than that, right? More than that, you can just utilize like Python standard library you can use. Sometimes you might need something else. Okay, Python standard library might not have what you need. And then you can just search for different areas, extra modules. That means, like these are called third party modules. Right, I'm going to show it to you how to access a standard library as well as a third party library. It's easy. There's nothing. This will help us to extend Python code, and maybe you can just make your Python code more powerful, right? So let's start back. Let's go back to, and we'll start with a built-in module, right? Let's start. I'm going back to my code. I'm going to save it. Yes, save. Now I'm going to create another file called ex2.py Python. Right. Now let's start. Python has a built-in function called import. This is where you start. Import a module. Right. There are lots of modules. You can just search in Python documentation. I'm going to talk about one module. It will be the same for everything. I'm gonna create an example as well using this Python module. It's a import random. a simple module. What does it do? It says random is not, that's okay. Now it says random variable generators, bytes, integer, sequences. This is a documentation of that library, right? This is the module. How do you import a, get a module inside your Python code? So here, if you look at this previous code, nothing there because we used built-in functions. Now we're going to get some extra functionality to generate some random integer numbers. It says import random. This is the first point you start. How do you do that? You start with import keyword and then the module name. It doesn't matter whatever the module. This will be, these are coming from Python standard library, a random. And then if you need third party modules, it will be the same. You have to install the module first and then use import, right? Now we have a library. Next step. Next step, I'm going to create another variable called role. Whatever the variable, say random, and you just press dot. See, now you will see lots of methods. These are called methods, lots of methods here. Now we have lots of methods inside your random module. See, different methods to create different things, right? That's some methods. I'm going to use a method called, I'm going to say random int, see rnd int. This is the function I'm going to use. See random dot random rnd int, right? Int, if you let's say int, random int, this is the function. Now let's save it and just test it. What will happen? Right, let's say Python, and I need example 2 to be executed. Just press enter. So nothing happens. Let's say random. But if you look at this one, this function has two parameters. See, this function has two parameters. That means this random, this will be a random main. This is called a class. And then it has a method called random int, rand int. And then it has two different variables or parameters, including A and B. So let's see what are these A and B says. It says return a random integer in a range of A, B. That means this will, A will be starting range, B will be the ending range. That means if you want to create a random number between 1 to 10, you have to say 1 comma 10. Let's see. Let's create a random int. I'm going to say starting 1 comma 10. So it will be just, now when you execute this function, now we have random. When you execute this method, it will generate a number between 1 to 10 and put it inside this variable, right? Let's try to print it. Let's print roll and save. Let's clear my code, clear. And yeah, I have cleared the code and I'm going to say Python, execute the, see now you got a number called 1. See, now if you execute it again, now it had given 8. See, now what does it was like, it will pick up any number between 1 to 10 and it will randomly print. How many times you have just run, just say different numbers. See 9, different numbers, 1, 7, 9. It will be totally random numbers. This is how now we have used a module called random, and we used a random mean method inside this random class. This is one way of doing it, right? This is first line one. Now, let's bind together. I'm going to say another pin, say print. With F, let's say format U rolled. Now the roll, the number. Let's save it. Clear, and then run the code. Python now say you rolled 8. So we know it, right? Now there's another one. So normally what you can do is like, now we have used this method, this module directly, that means name name of that module. Normally, we just when you import something, we can just create an alias for this module. This is how you just, this is syntax as whatever the alias name, I'm going to say, just say alias. See, now what happened? Now it gives an error. It says, okay, random is not defined. You couldn't find out. Even though if you just save it and when you just say, execute this program, you can just say Python ex2.python and see, it gives an error saying, oops, sorry. It gives an error saying random is not defined. That means your Python code doesn't understand what random is. Why? Because we gave an alias, a name. Then from now on, you have to call it as alias. Now it works. Now just save it, let's clear it. And just say Python example 2. Now you say you rolled 7. See, now it works fine. But don't give aliases like this. It shouldn't be like aliases because it should be explaining what we are doing right now. What sort of problem we're going to solve, right? Now looks like this. This looks like a dice rolling. So that's why I'm going to say, I'm going to rename it into dice. Now it's more readable, more understandable, human readable. These are called human readable. Let's say dice. Now we have this dice, save. Now it looks like a nice code, import random mass dice and roll dice random mint, get something from here, 1 to 10, right? Now we have this number. Now let's save it. Let's Python. This is how you do that, right? Again, there'll be another number, right? Now as a recap, if you want to import something from the standard library, that means Python standard library. If you want to import something, you can just straight away, you have to read the documents. You will get all the standard library modules. This is how you start. Import module name. If you want, this is optional. If you want an alias, you can just say as dice or whatever the as, or maybe something else. So then you can just say role. Then after this line, if you put an alias, then you have to use this name. Right, that's a must. So that's why it says dice. Else, if you don't have something like this, then you have to directly use, you can just use random. Now we have printed one, right? That says random as dice. Now we have, now you know how to import something from standard library. What next? What if there's a third party library if you want to install, right? Third party library package, you have to, when you install Python in your application on your machine, on your Windows or Linux or Mac machine, you will get a utility called pip. This is called Python package installer, right? What is a Python package? Next, we'll just call, just for now, if you just say enter, so it gives you a small usage. It says pip command the options. What does it do? It installs packages. What are these packages? Package is like this, right? Let me go back to my PowerPoint. I'll explain what is a package. Let's click enter. Yes. Now we know about Python standard library. And now we are talking about this third party stuff, right? Imagine you have a Python code. This is my Python code, right? Python code. This Python code, you are doing something, maybe you are creating something, or maybe you create some functionality. This Python code might use other modules as well. Maybe it might use something like this. It's using a module called, maybe just say other module. Right? It might use another module. Module 2, maybe I'll just use a different module, right? Same Python code. Now, these two are called, this is your own Python code, but you are using something, another module, yeah. Let's say another module, right? Two different modules. You have your Python code, but you use these things. Now, when you start using these things, third-party modules, you'll be totally, then you will be saying as, I'm gonna put like this, yeah. and then we're using these two, right? I'm going to use two different modules. I have my Python code, and then I have another module, two different modules. So because I'm using these two are totally, let's say, make it a little bit smaller and delete. And this is my Python code. Now, this module is inside my code, and this module as well as this module will be inside my code, right? So because these two are used by my Python code. For example, now what will happen? These modules are not there. I'll just say not there. Now, because I'm looking at these two modules, I couldn't find it. So there'll be an error in my code. It says, okay, an error in my code saying, okay, my code doesn't work. It won't work without these two modules. So these two modules will have to be there. So we are calling in code, we just call them as, we're going to say, these are dependencies. Dependencies to my code. It's a word calling in programming. We can say these two are dependencies. This is dependency one. Both of them are dependencies. This one is a dependency. And this one as dependency for my code. Two different dependencies. Because my code depends on this module and this module, the green one and the blue one. So that's why these are called dependencies, right? A package means, what if this Python code, you have to use somebody else's Python code, depends on these things. Then when you get this Python code as a module, and you should get all these dependencies as well, right? These are called dependencies. So these, you need this. So what Python has done, like what people have done, the developers done it, like, okay, we can't just say other people to ask, I have my code, please, when you just get this code, make sure you have these dependencies as well, right? You can't say that. So that's why these developers create a method called packaging. We package everything into one module, one thing. Go back. We create them as one thing, right? These are called packages. Third-party packages. That means if you want something to use this code, please get this package entirely, one as one thing. So when you get this package, we can just say a name for this. Maybe imagine print format date, a package. So format date, you'll get your code, Python code, plus whatever the dependencies to that code. You don't have to worry about. When you install this, everything will be installed within. These are called packages. So Python has a package manager to manage these different packages. Different packages, right? Lots of packages, different colors. Maybe this will be another package. Right? Make sure this will be another package, or maybe another one. This will be another package saying, okay, lots of third-party packages are there. I'm going to say change this color into something else, then you will understand. Okay. Lots of third party packages. I'm running out of colors now. Say nice green. Yeah. Lots of packages. So to manage these packages, you need a package manager, right? If somebody asks, okay, it should be version. Version means maybe this will be version one, and then you might need version 0.1, something like that. Maybe you have like version 3, then you might need version 2. All this versioning, all this management will be done through the package manager. So this is called a package manager on Python. They have this thing called Python package index. This will be the website. I'll show you to the website. This website. Let me show you to. This is called find, install, publish Python packages with Python package index, PPI. Right? So this is, how do you call it? So normally the Python world know as PY and PI. That means PI. right? So this is how you call, these are lots of packages. You can search it here. Maybe you can just say, search it like, for example, HTTP. Maybe we see lots of packages for HTTP. Or maybe you can just say, REST API. See, lots of packages. You can just use these things. You can just install. This is called the package indexer. You search for this thing. For example, if I say emoji, I'm going to use this package, emoji, and you will get this package. So different versions, 1.5 emoji for Python, search emoji by keywords terminal, lots of things. Look at the updated date. See, it says September 17th. That means its latest update is there. When you click on it, you see how to install it. Right? This will be an index. It will explain it to you how it works. So because these guys are third-party people, third-party developers who develop these things, you can just totally look at these things and just search for. So the documentation will explain, so you don't have to worry about, I don't know. So even there are lots of new packages there, how to install this thing, I don't know. Just go there, go to this website. This is the website. So pypy.org/project/emoji. This is the package you're going to use, but by default, if you just go to this URL, you will get the information of, okay, then you search for something. Now I'm going to look in at this emoji package. How do I install it? I'm going down, and then there are different methods of installing. You can, this is the easiest way. You can say pip install emoji. This means pip means the command, and then install. Let me check. Yeah. Pip is the command, the Python installer, the package installer, and then the option is to install. Please use this command and install, and the package name. Package name is emoji. And if you want, you can just straight away upgrade. Or else, another way of doing is like straight away get it from your Git repository and then go to that folder and then use this, install it. So it's better this method. It's easy. This is how you do that. Right? Let's go back. Let's install this package and try it out. Now we're going to learn about how to see at the top. Every package has this one, pip install emoji. How do you do that? Let's go back to my code. I'm going to use this one. We have used this random dice. Let's say exercise 2. Let's save it. I'm going to create another file called exercise3.py. I'm going to close these two. Now I'm going to open my, let's clear my terminal. I'm looking back to my documentation. I'm going back to my documentation. I'm going to look at it in the document saying, okay, how to install. It says pip, the command, and install emoji. Let's go back. Say pip install emoji. See, simple as that. Pip install emoji. And if you want to upgrade, you can just say another extra option, upgrade. Or you can just say, just simply say install, and it will install. Right? That means requirement, because I already installed it, or I can just say, let's say upgrade. Upgrade means it will get the latest command and it will just download it and install it. After that, after this command, you can easily use this package. How do you use it? Next step. Remember the package name? The package name is emoji. So import the package name or import the module name. Same thing. Let's say import an emoji. See, it will give the answer. Or you can just say an alias as, maybe you can just say icons, right? Icons. Now, next step, how do you use it? Right, I have installed it. I'm going to add a code. I'm going to say message, say icons dot. So because I have an alias here, icons dot, see. I'm going to say message emojis. This is another method, emojis, see. And now enter your string, and you can just say aliases as well. So I'm going to say like, say Python is great. Now you can say thumbs up. This is how you give thumbs. Let's say the L, say thumbs up. Yes, thumbs up. And close this. So this is how you call this. So you don't have to remember these things. You just go to the documentation. Documentation will explain everything. So this is our string, and this is how you, so great, it should be great, right? So you have to just say, this is how you replace an emoji, colon, and then the name, and then colon, right? So let's save it. And then next line, I'm going to say print message. Save. Let's say clear. Let's say Python, ex3.python. Oops, why is that? Oh, spelling mistake. Should be Python P, not Python. Clear. Python ex3.py. Now see, so I have messed up something like this. See, the thumbs up, maybe it's wrong. So let's go to the documentation and then have a look at it, how to use it, right? So let's go back and see, it should be, see, thumbs up. So you can just use this method, underscore up. Let's go back. It should be underscore thumbs up. Let's try it. Or maybe we can just try another message. See, now you get an emoji icon. See? So this is how you do that. Now you have this emoji here. So Python is great. Simple as that. Now we know how to install a third-party package. We know what is a package, and then we know how to install it, and we know how to use it. This is how you use these things within Python, right? As simple as that. So let's go back. Now we have imported. We used an built-in function, and then we used a library from a module from the Python standard library, and we have installed a third-party library, a package, and we used it. Now three things we have used, right? This is how we do in Python. Next step. Let's say, go back and just check whether what's next. So now we have learned an inbuilt function. We have import something. Let's look at some change in the programming, what you call this flow, right? This is how we use this. I'm going to use this one. This is a third party. This is an application normally I use for training, and this is called draw.io. This is very cheap, it's free. You can use create flowcharts and lots of things. I really use this one when I teach in these things, right? So now imagine we have a nice little program. So we'll start this program like this. We said in the program, we said import random, right? So if you look at my code back, we have said import random, and then we use this line, roll dice. I'm going to copy this one. I've created another one. Next line, right? Yeah, use like this. Now, next step what I did was, now we have created another line like this. So like this. We created, that's too much. Let's say we created, say, role equals random dot rand int, I said 1 to 10, line 2, right? Now we have it, we did this, the line 2. Now, finally, what we did was like we said, print, we said F, you rolled, and say roll, we said this. So we had three lines of code. We had this code, three lines of code did something, right? Import random and import, do something and print it out. This is called a program flow, top to bottom. It flowed, right? So this is called programming flow. So whatever the programming flow will be when you start a program, when you execute it, you'll start from top to bottom and execute and do something, right? So this is called a normal flow. Sometimes we might have to break this flow, right? Do something. Like for example, we might have to make a decision and then change, do something else. So for example, if I just say, if I come here, if you want to make a decision like this, let's say a decision. Sorry. Right. If you want to make a decision like this, depending on the decision, check something. I'm going to say check something. I want to check something and change this flow. It shouldn't go. If check something is happening, just make it, maybe I can just say, if something is true, it's okay. Go this way. Or maybe I can say, go another way. Say, do some other Python work, right? And finally, I'm gonna say, print something. Now what happened, right? Now this program flow, when you just think about normal flow was like from top to bottom, right? So we had this from top to bottom. Now we just change that flow. In the middle, we check something and then we change. If you say, okay, check something, if it works, maybe like check whether you have an ID card. If you have an ID card, go this way. If you don't have an ID card, go this way. Two different paths in your programming. That it starts like this and you made a decision and then it went this way. And you made another, depending on the result, it went this way, right? Or the green path or the purple path. Now you made a decision to change the flow of the code. This changing flow of this code, there are two methods in programming language. Every programming language has this thing, two ways. Like there's one way of like conditions. Now we are check something means conditions. So checking a condition, we change the flow of the code. So we change the direction of the code. It doesn't direct from not top to bottom. Now it's going to be left to right. So maybe you can just say, okay, go through the purple lane or go through the green lane. But you have to check something. Depending on that check result, we decide which way it goes. Now we are going to learn this sort of changing the flow of the code, right? From now till now, we learn one flow. It's from top to bottom. It works charming, right? Now what we said, these are called conditions. There are two different things on programming, changing the programming flow. The first one is conditions. There's another one called loops, iterations, loops. Two different things going to change your flow, conditions and loops. Now we are going to learn about some conditions. Let's start with some conditions. For conditions, let's get me back to my code. I'm going to delete, close. Now the third one, example 4. Now we are going to change the flow of our code using conditions. If, else, and else if. Three different things in Python. This is how you learn. Every programming language has these conditions, right? C sharp has it, Java has it, PHP has it. Every programming language has these things, right? Let's look at it that way. Let's start. This is how you start. Now I'm going to create the code. Let's come back like this. Okay. I'm going to create a program, start a value, a variable. I'm going to say 7. This is a string 7, a simple 7, or we can just say just 7. The value is 7, right? Now, the first line, now I need to check whether, if we just say print like this, the value is 7. And again, you're going to print finished, right? This is how you start the code. Now this is, we know the, this is the flow. It will just flow. It will be same value. And then it will be print this one and it will print this. If we just execute this code, say Python ex4.py, see value is 7, finished. If we just say value is 6, you save it. And you're going to print it, but still it will say value 7, finished. Now the program works, but we don't have any errors, but still there is a logical error here. Why? Because it's always say value 7, but it says 6 here. Understood? So it says 6 here, but when you execute the code, it always, it will output the value 7 and finished, value 7 finished. See, we don't do that. So now we're going to change the flow of the code. We do a check. This is how we start. If value double equal is 7. And then remember, every Python is like very sensitive about indenting. So code block, we have to define a code block. If has a code block, this one has a code block, then we have to put a colon and then see, automatically gives an error. Expected indent and block. See, please make sure I have my own block. Indent your code. So I'm going to say tab. Now, nice. See, press enter. See, now you have a code save. If value is 7, only print. Now look at this code. Look at this code. It says if, this is the keyword we are using. And then we're going to do a check. Please check whether the value is 7, right? And these are called Boolean operators, Boolean assignment. See this line, the small area. I'm going to change the color and then I'm going to say this area. This is not an assignment operator. This is called a Boolean check operator, like double equal. You have to do that, right? This is the syntax. So value is 7. Check whether the value is 7. Yes. So this will output this, the red box will output two different outputs. The first output will be, the first one will be true. There'll be two different outputs. The second one will be, there'll be another output. If you want, it will say false. One of these, two different things. This red box will output a true or a false. At the moment, the value is 6. We're going to check whether it's 7 and it will output false, right? And the values, it will check like that. So in if conditions, there should be always an output. In simpler word, the if condition should look like this. If true, print, do something. This is a simple word. The true, we're going to check here. So this condition will always will be true and always this will be printed, right? So that's the way. But we need to check this true will be output, true or false. Same. It doesn't matter. Now it doesn't go inside. So true or false, what will happen? This condition, this check will be output a value of true or false, right? These are called a Boolean value. I'm going to show it later. Now let's go back and look at the code. Let's clear. Right. Now let's say Python ex4.py, enter. Now it says finished. Why is that? Because the item is, the number is not 7. That's why it doesn't go inside. Right. Now if it says 7 here, let's play it. I'm going to say Python. Now it says the value is 7. Now it says finished, right? It's printed. This is how you do that. Now, if you go back to this one, right? Let's delete everything. Let's start back with this code. Now we have a text box saying value is 7, right? We have a code. Next time, what we're going to do is we're going to do a check. Check whether the value equals, actually check whether the value is actually 7, right? Now, if it is 7, print saying the value is 7. If it is not, do nothing and then finish it. Now finish. Finish, yes, right? This is how the code works. The second round works like this. Works like this. Right, it works like this. See what happened. So now the value is 7, it checks whether the value is 7, yes, and then go inside and then finish the code. Right? Else, if not the value is 6 or whatever, not 7, 6, it will check and then it's not true and it go this way and then finally finish. It skips this part. The same thing happened in your code. The same thing, right? This is the if keyword and this is the Boolean expression, the expression we check, and this is the required colon mark. This is must. Because Python syntax and then indenting will support here. Look what will happen now. What will happen when you just put 6 here? Let's save and then execute the code. Now it says just finish, it skips. So it doesn't go inside, right? That means this value, the Boolean expression is false. It's not true. It doesn't go. Always if true, it goes inside, else it doesn't. Right now, look what will happen if I hit a tab here. What will happen? Now let's save it. Let's save it and then let's run again. Right, let's run the code again. Now nothing printed. See, now if you make it, the value is 7. Let's save it now. What happened? Now we have value is 7. Now finished. See what happened? Now look at this line. Visual Studio Code has understood, right? Okay. If you put a colon and then the indent this area, indent this area, that means it will treat as everything inside this if block. This is called a scope. Inside if scope, that means values till value 7 run everything. If it's not, it doesn't know anything. Thus, indenting on Python will understand, okay, this print, whatever the indenting is equal, if you have 100 lines of code, it will treat it as after if block. Whatever the true, run, false, escape, don't do anything. Like I'll show it to you, if I just go back and put some 2 spaces here, look what will happen. Let's run the code again and then see what will happen. Now it gives an error. See, the error is this part. This is the way, the one you have looked. Unindented does not match any outer indented level. That means it doesn't know the indented level. So make sure always you look at your indenting. At least you start with here, the same line. That means this block will be executed as one. This block will executed as one. And this will be a separate block. And this will be separate, right? Because the indented. So if you have an indent like this, with the space, hit tab, and then look at this, it will be one block. See, one block, another part. So this is, you have to make be careful when you're using if else conditions, because of this indentation, it might not pick up from your scope, right? Now that we know, next step. We learn about indenting. Let's look at the else part. Now I need this finish every time we need. So whatever the number, it should be finishing. The finish must be printed. Now I'm going to put an else. So that means the false value, it should start not from here. It's wrong, right? It should be from the beginning. It should be under if space. Now if value is 7, whatever the number, not 7, it will go inside this. Now I'm going to say print else, and then remember the must colon, and then it will understand the block. I'm going to say print. The value is not 7. Now let's check. Right? To start with value 7, let's write the code and then say clear Python. Now it says value is finish 7, and then you got the finished method. Now if you just say 6 or whatever the not 7, whatever the number, you save it, you execute it, and then you say the value is not 7 and finished. See, this is how the else block work. Else block, again, the indenting. See, still, if you have another print, else block, still it will run. So it will be treated as one block. Make sure the colon and the keyword is most very important when you write Python code. This colon, this one, this colon is very important here and here. Even though we remember when we write an, we wrote a function and it was like, we used it, right? Now next. Now let's create the value, another value. I'm going to say value is 8, right? Else. Next step will be, we're going to introduce another one called another method. Now we know if, we know else. Now we're going to talk about elif, right? It should be always after if. Else should be every always the last one, right? So I'm going to go back here. I'm going to say elif. Elif, you can't just say elif is like this. If it is not this value, and else if. Other programming language, you have like, you have to give else and space if. Here, in Python, you have elif, and then you can just say, again, you have to do a check, say value equals 8, and again, the colon, remember the colon, and say print, the value is 8. See, it says value is 8. It's now value is 7, and then value is 8. This is how else these things work. Let's see, clear, and then run the code, says value is 8. Now, if you just say 7, and then see, value is 7. Always, now remember, always, even though if you want, you can just put another one saying else, elif, value is 9. And print can just say the value is 9. See? Now see, the if, check, check, check. And finally else, finally I'm going to say, I'm going to change this into, the value is not one we are looking for, right? Save. Clear Python, value 7. If you just say value is 9, we'll check everything. And oops, sorry, I didn't save it. Clear and value is 9. see, it says finished. Now if you just put not 7, not 8, not 9, say let 10, save it. It will check everything and it says the value is not the one we are looking for and it's finished. See, now you know this is how it works. It checks whether it's false, it goes to this one again, checks. Finally, it goes to the else. So this is how we do, how we work in programming, right? Now we know. Now never overlap these things. Like for example, so imagine if you're checking some number, or maybe you can just say value 7, always make sure you write nicely and then indenting. So you should know, right? Now next step. Next step we are looking at, I'm gonna create a new file. I'm gonna say exercise5.python. Nice. Now we are going to look at nested ifs. Nested if means these are not nested ifs. These are like just checking stuff, right? Nested if works like this. Now I'm going to say first value. Let's say true. Second value equals 8, whatever the number, maybe 7, right? Let's say, I'm going to check first value. If first value is true, and then again, colon, see? Because this is true and you don't have to do something like this. So now second value, enter. If, these are called nested if, another if, not elif, just f, if. Second value, I'm gonna check for 7. And again, colon, print. Got here, I'm here. See, the first value is true and then second value, see? These are just normal. This is called nested if. After the second line, it should be true because when you need to print, these both of these values should be true. So it should be true at the first one, else it won't go inside and it'll exit. Right? Let's try it. We'll understand. Let's clear. And then say Python ex5.py. See, got here, we are there. Now, one of these doesn't matter. Imagine just this one is false. Let's save it and Python. See, nothing prints. Even though if it's true and this one doesn't match, 9, just save and it still doesn't print. It should be, both values should be matched here in the nested if, right? It depends on your requirement. You can just use this nested if. These are called nested if, right? Now you understood the code, how it works. Let's do something like this. Let's create a small program, right? Let's understand about these Boolean expressions, like different types, how it works. What are those types and then different types. Let's close, and then say exercise 6. We'll understand more about Boolean values. Why we are using this, why these Boolean values. Now let's say print, I'm gonna say type. Remember we started with this, we're gonna say hello world, right? And now I'm gonna use the same thing. You can just say shift and down arrow, shift, alt, and down arrow, you can duplicate. See, that means how to use shift plus alt plus down arrow. You can duplicate this code. Shift, alt, see? You can duplicate. So it will make sure you write nice code. And then I'm going to say not hello world, let's 7, there was a number, and press enter. That's another one. So print, say type true, shift alt underscore. I'm going to say false, and I come back, I'm going to say print type inside single quotes true. I'm going to do the same here for false. Let me show you. Okay, I'm going to do this, right? Save it. Let's execute it. Clear. Say Python example 6. See what happened. The first two. Let me go through the output and it like this. See, the first one says string. See, again, this is a string. See, and the second one, it says integer and integer. These two said Boolean, Boolean. See, true and false are Boolean. And even though if we just say true and false inside single quotes, it says string. This is how you check the type. These are called types. Now, these are Boolean values are used for expression, the Boolean expressions for checking things, right? So let's get back and then you have this output. Now what will happen? I'm going to use another function. Remember we used int and string. We're going to use like this. I'm going to say print Boolean value, convert to Boolean, true, right? And then I'm going to do the same. I'm going to say false. Look, the answer, what will the answer will be, right? Again, I'm going to do a blank. Single, that means the blank means like this. So just double single quotes together, just one by one, and it will be treated as a blank. This one will be treated as something like this. If you put a space, that means this is a space, two different things, right? Make sure this is two different things. Oops. Now, next one. Let's say print Boolean. Hello world. Look what will happen. I'm going to save it. I'm going to clear and run this code exercise 6. So what happened? So there were. We look at these two, only false was this one. See, the false value is the blank value. Everything else has treated as true. Now, if you convert something into Boolean, even though a string or whatever it is, if it is has a value, a true, false or value, it will treat as true. Only false will be if there is a blank value. Because we check these things when we write code, we check these things whether if it is a blank, that means we can just check if, check the text, whatever the text coming from outside and then do something. That means if it is blank value, that means false, it won't do anything. So if you have, it's a nice method to check whether converting into a Boolean or whether checking it is, you can just say, see, everything is true and this one is only false. See, true, false, only the blank one treated as false. Remember this one when you write code, right? That's one way of doing it. And again, you can just do the same for numbers. You can just check for numbers. You can just say 7 and maybe another number 1. And you can just check for a 0 and you can just check for a minus value. Right? Look at this, what will happen. And you save it and then clear the code, clear. Please run. Now look what happened. Right? Now the only false one, same. Like the blank value, only the false one is the 0. See? The 0 is the false one. So always in numbers, when you're checking, maybe if you're using numbers, any number rather than 0 will treat it as true, even a minus number, that means it has a value. Only zeros will be false. Normally what we check is ones and zeros. So even greater than 0, whatever greater than or less than 0 will treat it as true, else only 0 will be treated as false, right? You have to remember. So now you have to think about two things. Blank values will be treated as false and zeros will be treated as false. That's the thing you have to remember when you write code in Python or maybe when you're checking with expressions. So these are the called Boolean. Now let's check what are the Boolean expressions, right? So if you look at these things, 1 + 1 = 3, and 1 + 1 = 2, right? Two different things. What will be true? What will be false? Let's try that. Let's print. Let's say print. Right now, it will get an error. Print. See, little error. Now, these Boolean expressions are wrong. So, equal means as an assignment, not an expression, not a Boolean expression. For that, you have to give another equal. See. Equal. Now it works. Now let's check which one will be true, which one will be false. Clear. When you say print, sorry, Python. See, the first one is false. 1 = 3. The second one is true. That means this is correct. Right? These are the Boolean expressions we used to work with, right? Now you have to understand whether now this will be an error. So it says syntax error. So you don't know, you don't just do like this. This is expression. These are how we treat as Boolean expressions. So next will be the operators. These are not operators. Operators will be equal, plus, minus, those things, but these are called Boolean expressions, right? You have to remember those things. There are lots of Boolean expressions. These are called comparison operator. This one is a comparison operator. This is how you compare. Left side is 3, this side is 2. And this is called a comparison. There are lots of comparison operators. You can start with double equal, will be checked whether it is equal, and this is not equal, and this will be greater than, and this will be less than, and, oh, let me do like this. This will be treated as equal, check equality, and then not equal, and greater than, this will be less than, and greater than, no equal, less than, no equal, and finally there will be we have a not equal as well. So these are called comparison operators. These are for checking, right? Let's check something like that. And there's another one called, let's check something like this. Let's write a small code for this. I'm gonna say value equals 10 if value is greater than 10 or maybe greater than 5, print you it's, or maybe, yeah, let's do like this. Let's say maths marks, say 50 or maybe 40. I'm gonna say if maths marks are greater than 49 or maybe 50. Let's say print, you have passed maths. And else you can say print, you need to try again. You can say print, good day, and save. What will happen? Now the marks is 40, now we're going to use a comparison operator, right? You can say Python, see, you need to try again. That means the marks are 40. What will happen? The marks are 55. Again, save it, execute, say you have passed maths. What will happen if it is 50? Exact 50. Let's clear and test it. So again, you need to try again, because that means greater than 15 means 50 means it's not 50. So if you want to pass the 50 guy as well, you have to say greater than or equal to 50 and save it, and then try it again. See, you have passed that. So that's how you check. The next step is, now we have learned about arithmetic operators, and we learned about logical comparison operators, right? The greater than or equal. And then we're going to learn about now, what are the logical operators? we have learned three things, right? Let's save this code and close this and create another one called EX7.python. Now we are going to look at logical operators, right? Logical operators. This is how it works. Logical operators, like, let's say like this. I'm going to say first number is 5. And I'm going to say second number is 0. And true value, simple value, you can say true. And false value, I'm going to say false. Now we have 4 different variables, right? I'm going to check if first number greater than 1, now I'm going to enter a logical operator called AND. First number less than 10, right? And go to the next slide. Say print, the value is between 1 and 10. So it works, right? It says the value, that means greater than 1. Make sure, now this is 1, right? And this will be logically tested first. That means greater than, we're going to have a comparison operator saying, okay, first number is greater than 1. Yes, first number is 5. That means, yes, it is greater than 1. And check this part, the right side. Again, check whether the first number is less than 10, 5, yes. So that means on the right side will be true, and the left side will be true. Again, the right side will be true. True and true is true. Then it will go inside, right? So this is, if you heard about the truth table, that means true is true, and false is false, and false true is again false, and true false is again false, right? This is with the AND operator, AND logical operator. T and T is T, and F, everything else will be treated as false. So I can just show it to you. Yes. Now clear the code. Right, let's say we have saved it. Python ex7.python. Enter. See, the value is between 1 and 2. Now if I just say 0 and save it. Now run. See, nothing prints. That means it doesn't go inside. Even 11. Save it. See, it doesn't go inside. Only thing between, let's say 9, save it. Now it works, right? This is how the AND operator works. Now let's check with the other operators. I'm going to check like this. If the first number, yes, greater than 1, that's no problem. And the second number, again greater than 1, print at least one value is greater than 1. At least one value is greater than 1. If you understood. Now I'm going to check whether the first value, I'm going to say, let's make it 5, save. Yeah. First and second number. I'm going to check, not N, it should be O, sorry. Right? Now I'm going to check whether the first number is greater than 1. I'm going to say yes, the first number is greater than 1. That's true, no problem. O means whatever. One of these should be true. That's enough, right? So second number or greater than 1. It's not greater than 1, but still this one is true. Then you need to go inside. Let's try that. Let's save it. And I'm going to say xPython. Now at least one value is greater than 1. How it works? On O operator, it says true is true, and even false true is true, and true false even true, and false false false. This is how it works with the O operator. If this is true, this is true, go inside. At least one is false. This is false, but still this is true, but still go inside. Again, this is true and this is false, but still goes inside, because the third one worked here because the first number is greater than one. See, now I'm going to change this one value. I'm going to delete this and let me try this again. I'm going to say this one is greater than, not greater than one, but this one is greater than one. Let's save it. Now at least one value is greater than one because the second number is greater than one. What will happen? Both are zero. Both are failing. See, nothing happens. This is how the O operator works. Seven. Now we have learned about the AND operator and we have learned about the O operator. There's another operator called NOT operator. This is how it works. I'm going to say print true value. I'm going to save it. The last line 14, right? Clear. Run and it says true. See, the last one, it says true. This is how it works. Now it says this is the value true. That's correct. See, this and this. It says true. The NOT operator will do the opposite. If you just say NOT in front of it, NOT, and save, and then when you execute this one, look what happened. Oops, yeah. See, now it says false. Here, false. Because even though we have named as true here, see, the true value, if it is not true value, that means false. Again, the other way around is print, not false value will be written as true. This is how the NOT operator works. Let's execute, see, false true. Right, now you understand how these things works. Let's combine together. I'm gonna go on this line. I'm gonna say like this: if first number, right, greater than one, and the second number is greater less than 10, right, in this code, I'm gonna say print both values pass the test. And else, tick, it comes here and colon, let's say print both values do not pass the test. Let's see what happens here, right? The first number, I'm gonna just remark these things. I'm gonna remark all these things. It doesn't work now. So let's, the first number is 7, the second number is 0. So that means first number is, let's, as a reminder, let's say first number is 7 and second number is 0. Let's try that. Code, what will happen? Let's save it and execute. Both values pass the test, right? That means 7 is greater than 1, that's okay, that's correct. And this one is second number is less than 10. So this is true and this is true. True, true means go inside. Now I'm going to do something else. I'm going to do like this. I'm going to say not. This is how you mix things. So I'm going to say not. Let's say clear. Look what happens. Now says both values do not pass the test. Why is that? Because this value returns true, that's okay. But NOT operator will change that true value into again false. Remember, false and true will be always false and it goes this way. So this is how it works, right? Now you understood how these logical operators work, right? We start with these things. We said, okay, numbers, we just checked some numbers. Now we are just slowly going to complex small things, right? Let's go back and try a small code. So I'm going to write a code here. Let's say example 8ex, 8.python. I'm going to say like this. This is my code. I'm going to say, like, there'll be a message saying, would you like to continue? Continue. And with a question mark and space, and the program will wait for you to type something. If you type yes, right, the output would be continuing and complete. Like that. This is one way of doing it. Another one, the question will be same question. Let's copy, paste here. The question will be asked, same copy. If you just type no, and it will return just saying no, complete, just say exit. That's it, two different outputs. The question will be asked from you, this is the program I'm going to write. Using what we have learned right now, I'll say, would you like to continue, please? If you just type yes, continuing, complete. And again, when you run the program, you say, would you like to continue? If it says no, and then it will be say exiting, right? This is the requirement. Now I'm going to write the code, right? Two different outputs, depending on the answer. You can type either yes or Y, or you can type no or N. But you can type anything else, right? But if you type anything else, what will happen? Right? You're going to type something else. You can say, I'll just say copy. And if you type something else, maybe saying, sorry. Right? And then the message should display, please try again. And respond with yes or no. A small help, we can say help. Same, please try again, respond with yes or no. We just take yes or no, yes or no, like that. But both of it, you can just say why yes, yes, or you can just say why just why, or you can just say no or else no, on any, right? So three different outputs depending on your answer. Now we're going to use this in as an application. We're going to write a small Python application, Python program to solve this, right? Let's say continue. Let's type the code. Now this is the Python code value. I'm going to take now Python has a function called input, which will wait for you for your input. I'm going to ask the question, would you like to continue? The space. Now it will. I'm going to say where if the value is now simple y, yes. Or see one of these, or you can say value is check the value for yes. Then print saying continuing dot dot dot. And the next line print, complete. See, now value is Y or value is yes. Now I'm going to check for else, L if value is no N or value is no. And again, print, say exit. So that means we're going to leave. Finally, it's not Y, yes, not one of these letters, else, finally, else, make sure, print the help. I'm going to copy paste this help. Print the help. See, a simple, small program we created, learning what we have learned right now today, right? So let's say, I'm going to say clear. So now let's execute the program Python ex8.py. enter. Now it worked. Wait for this one. See, would you like to continue? I'm going to say yes or why. See, continuing complete. Again, I'm going to execute the code. Would you like to continue? I'm going to say yes. So it works fine. Now clear. Again, I'm going to execute. Would you like to continue? No. So execute. Again, no. Exiting. Now I'm going to type something else. Yes or no, apart from yes or no. I'm going to say Fikri. Enter. See, help. Please try again and respond with yes or no. Right? So this is for today. We just learn how to... stop sharing. Today we have learned about, right? So how we learned about how to create this if statement, we change about how to breaking the flow of this application. We have, we created like 8 examples. We learn in and out about if then else, if else, and then we learn about how these variables work, how the Boolean expressions work, what are the logical operators, what are the assignment operators, what are the arithmetic operators. We learn about those things, right? So that's for today. I think you learned something. If you have any questions, you can just ask right now. It's over to you, guys. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fikri, for the valuable information on today's content on Python. Now it's time for Q&A session. Let's look at the submitted questions. The first question is, can we start freelancing with Python?
Yes, definitely. You can just start. So first you have to learn about the things, you know. So make sure if you're doing freelancing, it's not just Python, you can do anything, right? Python, C#, whatever it is, there are lots of Python requirement. If you look at like freelancing websites like Upwork, if you go there, make sure you just sell yourself first, right? There are some tests inside there. You have some tests inside this Upwork kind of thing. You pass those tests and then they give some small certifications. You just look for small challenges like creating something. And then you start from that, build a reputation for you. Then the work will come to you like it's like flooding work. Lots of work out there for Python. You just go to Upwork and search for saying Python requirements projects, and then you will just list lots of Python requirements. So there's another way. Python, like most of the people are looking at, if you look at Python, most of these guys are looking at this data sciencing and data side. But there's another world on Python called web application development, right? If you look at Django, there's a library, a module called Django with Python, you can develop web applications. So look at that part as well, because lots of vacancies, lots of work are there as well. Not just data science, not just data mining, crunching, those. Not just, there's another part called web application development on Python. Look at Django with Python, right? So, yeah.
Okay, so the next question is, what are the exercise or project sources available to train Python?
Okay, if there are lots of things, if you search on YouTube, you have lots of Python done. If you go to Microsoft website called docs.microsoft.com/learn, there's a total learning path for Python end to end from like what I'm doing. So I also reference that Microsoft documentation. You can look at those things. It's a lot of YouTube and Microsoft Learn. And then even the very best places to learn is like Python is python.org, the website itself. Go to the documentation, read one by one, try it out. And try combine search words like how to create a website using Python. Then you will get lots of tutorials out there.
Yes, the next question is, in face recognition door locking system, how can we use Python? If the peak is similar 85%, LED bulb is lighted and the door is unlocked, if not?
Okay, so that's
should
not
be light in the red.
Yeah, okay. So the question is like, it's not a Python question, actually. It's like an IoT or whatever the things you are going to develop, those kind of things. Like if the door lock is something that it's that to a logic, whatever the logic you think about. So the IoT data mining or maybe AI, Python is just a programming language. Make sure that's a programming language. You learn it properly. And then next step, everything else is your logic, right? If the door is locked or not, the red bulb should, the red bulb should on, right? If the door is open, the green bulb should on. So how do you do that? So you can just, like we did on this if this else conditions, that's logic. The flow should be, the first thing is you have to learn how to get this information using an IoT device or whatever the device you use. So that device has a documentation saying, okay, these are the parameters you get from that. Imagine the parameter will be say, okay, the green light is on, you will get a message called the light is on or off. Read that image, read that value, and then you can just straight away, you can use an if condition and saying, put a message or maybe you can just turn on another light. If the door is open, and then you can just send another message to a IoT device. So that's not Python, actually, that's the logic. Read the documentation, learn Python properly, and the logic is the best. Even an enterprise application, you have to use these things, if, else, conditions, loops, everything will be there. Learn Python first, and then you can just solve it yourself.
So the next question is, do you teach us about interface building using Python? Where can I learn more about building Python desktop applications?
Okay, this one is like our focus is on teaching the Python programming language. What are the bits and pieces of Python programming language? The other part, web application development, GUIs, like if you're on an Ubuntu machine or a Linux machine, there is a library called PyGTK. So you can just look at that one and then create Python code. Or if you're using Windows, there's another one called IronPython. And then using IronPython, you can use Visual Studio to build GUIs. It's up to you, depending what library you're using it. If you just you search for building Windows applications using Python, you can get lots of things, but we are not focusing on this building UIs, building stuff. The main focus on this one is like building, let you know about Python programming language it was, then you can decide what to do. GUIs or machine learning or anything, that's up to you.
The next question is, so can you tell the importance of knowledge in mathematics to work as a software engineer? Can a person who's weak in maths end up as a good programmer?
It's weak in maths is one way of thinking. It's not weak, right? So maths is like a different part. So normally when you start your university or whatever thing, there are maths, there's a module for maths. So you just learn about this Boolean algebra, whatever this, all these things you learn, sets and all those things, right? So that's it for your thinking. How do you solve problem? Right? Programming is not maths. Programming is not something else. Programming is solving a real world problem, right? Imagine you have a box, right? A box, and then you have some fruits. Maybe you have a mango, you have a pineapple, you might have some a few avocados, right? Now you have a problem with these fruits will fit inside the box. What if I ask you to create a program for that, an application for that, right? Now that's a real world problem, right? So then what you have to look at is you have to look at the requirement first, not about maths or something like this. Look at the requirement. The requirement is you have to fit these fruits inside the box, right? Then to check this, to write a software, whether to get an output, whether these things are going to fit or not, what are the variables you have to look at? Do you need the box color? No. Do you need the fruits color? Do you need whether these fruits are big, ripe or maybe tasty or not? No. All those properties are not necessary to solve this problem. Only thing you have to, the necessary one is, the size of these things, right? The size of the box and the size of the fruits. So now you know a variable, okay, how do I do that? First, you have to store something, get the value, the size of the box. Maybe the size will be 100. Now you have to check whether each fruit, avocados will be size 2 and 5 avocados will be 10, size of 10. Then you write the program using the sizes. Sorry. But the basic math knowledge is good enough. You don't need like a pro of maths, the basic knowledge. If you just calculate two values and you can just think about some logic. The logic is the main thing, thinking how to solve a problem. That's the programming. That means solving a problem is programming, not maths, not science, nothing else. Right? You have to think about like, don't worry about if you don't know maths. Maths you can learn, maybe take a course, a math, if you really need maths for like data science, all those things, you might need maths. But still for normal programming, like we do stuff, you don't need maths, but basic knowledge will be very good. Main thing is solving a problem.
The next question is, please explain what is ALICE, DICE and ROLL functions.
Okay, so these are the DICE is like in Singlish we call as a dhadu kate. DICE is English word, dhadu kate. ROLL means we just put get it and then we roll it 1 to 6. That's the thing I just spoke about. We'll just put, okay, it will get a random number, right? 1 to 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's the example I got. DICE is that small cube with these 6 numbers, and ROLL means you just throw away, you get a value out of that.
So that's the end of Q&A session.
Okay.
We have shared social media links of our speaker, Benzine Ventures, and also Edbicon in the chat box now. You can get to know about our speaker and the two organization and get updated on upcoming events by following our social media platforms. And also, we will keep sharing the attendance link for about another 10 minutes after session ends in the Zoom and also the FB as well. After that, we're going to close the link. So please make sure to fill that form. Once again, I would like to thank our speaker, Mr. Fikri Ismail, for the valuable information shared with us today. So we have come to the end of our second session of our workshop. We hope to see you all at the third session of our workshop, and it will be on 2nd of October from 5 p.m. onwards. We will inform you all in the future as well. Thank you for your participation on today's session. That's the end for today. Have a good night. Stay safe.